Hey folks, how's it going? It's been a while since I've last done a progression and planning, so I guess it's just about time for another one. I'm not feeling all that lost, but I do have to do some inventory and plan for a few more sparks, so let's start from there. Progression-wise, that's 274 draws for a nice 91%. I should have another spark ready in about 15 days. The surprise ticket shouldn't take too long to come back either. The last one was after a 90 days period, so we should go back to a 60 days cooldown for a bit now. The Subtics though, we'll get its own section later. A quick glance at my wishlist and it's already pretty obvious what banner I should blow my rolls on. Too bad we just got past this summer. Still, one spark is pretty much ready and we're heading towards the Halloween and Christmas banners. Too bad those are going to be followed by the New Year Zodiac release, Valentine and the anniversary right after. That's 5 big banners in 5 months, so picking one is probably going to be fairly hard. The only thing I know is that I'll probably want to spark on a Flashfest banner. Even if I did miss out on Leonet, I kind of won't wait for more grand character releases before sparking on Legfest again. This only cuts away one banner though, the New Year one, as every other one will go through the 15th. As far as characters go, I've recently realized I'm missing a few of the more meta-like characters, like Granjean, Robomi and Summer Noise, so I might try to rectify that with a Granjean spark. A chance for Shiva, Orchid and maybe even a new Flashfest grand character makes this option all the more juicy. I'm actually expecting another rebalance patch next month that's going to have some Halloween and Christmas characters in it. For a few of them, their kit is really showing its age, and they could use an upgrade. Also, it's going to make those two banners much more appealing in general. Right now, for the Halloween banner, Charlotta turned out quite okay after her rebalance, Cagliostro brings an elemental switch but I've never seen it used anywhere, Eustace is kinda dead, Danua is only home screen material, Lady Grey might be interesting for some dark stamina, Halle is perfect for your bombing and burst setups with Granjean, and Zeta and Azuraga are a great auto-attack character. We're bound to get two new characters as well, raising the number of interesting characters to hopefully 6. Too bad the Halloween banner only has the two new ones on rate up. Other banners also have one of the old characters in it, and last time the Valentine banner had all of its units on rate up and sparkable. If things change, it's going to make a Halloween spark much more appealing, but we'll just have to wait and see. Now Christmas! Last year we got 4 new characters separated in 2 banners, both before the roulette but still in the pool until December 25th. On one side, sparking right before the roulette and with no discount really doesn't sit well with me. On the other, last year's characters were pretty damn good and both Naru and Magisa are mainstay in our themes to this day. The other character I might consider going for from the Christmas banner would be Mary, mostly because she's cute. Last year, the Flashfest banner had Narmea and Cyrule, while also bringing Arlumea in for the rate up. Her original release was in 2016, so I don't think it's all that unlikely that we could see a Mary rate up this year. What's mostly going to come down to are going to be the characters. I need to see and evaluate the new Halloween characters before deciding if I want to skip that banner or not. The roulette or free draws will also bring a chance to get the Christmas characters from it, but at that point it will be too late to spark for them if you don't get lucky, and you'll be forced to wait for the anniversary ticket for one of them. I've already gone through that for Christmas Nermea, and I would prefer not to repeat that. So, unless the Halloween banner gets some old characters on rate up added to it, or the new Halloween characters are either too cute or broken to pass on, I think I'd rather spark on the Christmas Flashfest and then risk getting gold moons from the roulette. That's probably going to make the analytics list long as hell though, since I have zero Halloween characters, but that's just how things are sometimes. Before moving on to the next banners though, let's see when another spark might become available. I've needed to update my Crystal Income XL for a while now, so I took the opportunity to do just that. Like last time, I'm listing 30 days of login bonuses, one new story or box event, which I've begun 20 boxing consistently, followed by whatever else that month brings. That's 50 draws from the box event. Nothing really from the Xeno though, outside of the first clear rewards and the 50 crystal for the trophy that unlocks the Spear and Cap. For the Shadowverse collab, I copy-pasted the rewards from the Idolmaster one. They're both two-parters and come with two new characters. The rewards shouldn't differ all that much and add up to 19 draws. Hopefully, we'll also see a new milestone or collab Magnafest this time round, since it's been a while. Other than that, we've got the Love Live collab added to the side stories for another 4.6 draws and we're about to get the Tower of Babel for which we know nothing about. Hopefully though, it'll have some juicy rewards, cause right now we're still below 60 rolls for this month. This is fairly low when compared to the 65 to 70 plus we used to get. I'm afraid we might be paying for those 30k crystals they gave away some time ago. So, I've started September with 234 draws, and if my predictions are correct, I should reach 292 by the end of the month. Now let's see what's in stock for the future. Last October we've got the Siegfried event, another Rise of the Beast, a Proving Ground and a Fox event rerun. I think it's about time for another Proving Ground, but we're probably going to get another Duck PG rerun for the Feast and a new weapon before the Guild War. At this point I've lost all hopes for a light Proving Grounds. And even if it were to come by, these only bring less than 2 draws. Rise of the Beast is also fairly likely, either October or November, as they don't seem to let 3 months pass between a rerun and the other, and this one also has some new rewards, mainly in the form of the daily 100 crystals and the new raid badge collection, going up from 8 to 10 draws without counting for the first time clears. As far as shop events or rerun events go, if you've already played through them the first time, the crystal income for them goes down to 6 draws, since the trophies don't reset. It looks like October might come with as little as 45 draws, but this is also the release month of the March of the Valiant, which is supposed to be the new PvE crew content awarding Valor badges. Hopefully this will also have some decent crystal rewards, maybe not 30 draws like the Guild War, but I'm keeping my fingers crossed. As for November, we are sure to have the Light Guild War in it. The Guild Wars actually got a bit of an update, now coming with higher tier rewards, some of which include crystals. I usually stop at 500 million honors, I don't really have the time nor willpower to go for 1 billion, so that's only 2k more crystals from the honor rewards for me. Adding it all up, it's about 30 draws from each Guild War. Before the Guild War though, I believe we'll see the Xeno Diablos come back with the 5 star for its katana, and since the Mystery Collab is planned for December, I believe this month will just go by with a standard rerun event. Still, that's 62 draws minimum. As for December, we're guaranteed a collab, they say it's a mystery collab which will probably only be revealed during the Christmas stream, but I do have a feeling it's going to be Gachapin and Mukku again. As for the other events, I believe the Guild War and the March of the Valiant will start alternating each month. Also, since it's a new type of event, we'll probably just get a better version now and start seeing the first improvements for it here in December. Here we'll also almost surely see the New Year Magnafest and maybe even one more before that like last year. December is shaping up quite nicely with 64 draws without counting one of the major events, nor the stream. By the looks of it, I should start 2021 with 165 draws if I spark on Christmas. Still, the current expected crystal income is fairly low and I hope it's because of the Tower of Babel. If it's structured like most other games do their own towers, it's going to have X amount of floors to clear for various rewards and then reset once a month. For a lot of games, the tower is a very important source of resources, be it materials or currency, so I do hope that clearing the tower is what's going to bring the missing crystals for the usual 65 to 70 average monthly income. Either that, or we're about to see something pretty crazy in October when it comes to Magnafest or Twitter campaigns, cause there is no way we're only getting 45 draws in a single month. Still, even with this low of an estimate, I should be able to spark again come February. Without taking into account stream and giveaways, I should close February with 295 rolls, so it's pretty safe to assume that I should have the green light for a Valentine spark. As far as the characters go though, I've already gotten my Clarisse and I'm not really interested in the other three, so it might just be for one of the new releases and mostly only because those characters will not be available on the anniversary ticket. Also, SR Narmea. I do want that damn SR Narmea, so I might blow some rolls on Valentine regardless. After Valentine, the other option is going to be the anniversary. I've sparked once near the anniversary already for Andira, but this time around I think I'll still be going for a Flash Fest spark. The anniversary Flash Gala is going to be another chance at summer characters, with the banner usually having a new summer character and some rate up from the previous year. March 2020 had Tina, Yuel, Hal and Mal, Sandalphone and Jessica, which are characters from the previous year March release and from the first summer banner, with Jessica being the only exception being released on July 31st. For comparison, March 2019 had Yuel, Jean, Ilsa and Noise, with Yuel being new, Jean being from March 2018, and both Ilsa and Noise being from the July 31st Legfest. Even looking at other years, it would appear that the amount of characters on rate up is increasing, and the pairs they come from aren't exactly fixed. One thing's for sure though, the March 2021 Flashfest will have a new summer character and Tina on rate up. The other characters are going to be picked from the 2020 summer ones, and there might be four of them. I can't really predict much more, just hope there's going to be Rosamia and Mimblemel in that list. The possibility of scoring more 2019 summer characters is also still baiting me as well, so it's very likely that I'll spark on the anniversary Flashfest. After the anniversary though, rolling can honestly wait until summer, and then the cycle repeats. One character I haven't taken into consideration has been Condula, the Ox Zodiac, which will require a Legfest spark unless I get lucky with the free draws. I do hope the roulette will be merciful, else I might have to wait for her until the next September. Now for the surprise tickets. The wiki has an S collection tool for that, it even allows you to filter out the characters based on their banners. And there's my list. I don't think I need any more fire characters, even if Metera will be fun for Echo memes once I get Alanan. Satyr is cute, but she's kind of with support. For water, I'm only really interested in Leshia. She's got a real nice kit and also brings nukes from the backline. For Earth, I would have loved to get Pengi for an OTK team, but now that the Guild War has passed, so has that need. Wind has Alice in it, that's a really interesting character coming with an AoE assessing buff that also works off element. Light has Robomi, which is going to help immensely for a low button OTK setup. In Dark, I'm missing both Predator and Tanya. Tanya looks like a real fun character, and the delay on dodge when paired with Vicky sounds like it could be really fun to cheese some raids. Predator, on the other hand, comes with a unique attack boost for the entire team going up to 30%, Onslaught, guaranteed triple attack, dual strike, and overall a really crazy kit. She's also the last piece I'm missing for my Akasha Burst team, and I do believe she'll do wonders in the Light Guild War. There's really not much to think about here. I'm a bit sad about skipping on Tanya and Leshia yet again, but the next surprise ticket is going to go to Predator. ETA, 20 days or so. Next up is going to be the Eternal 5-star progress. I've promised myself I'd close the year with 5 of them at 5-star, and I'm only missing one to reach that goal. The next options are going to be 6, Siete and Neon. 6 for the next Guild War and for better gold boss farming, Siete for general use in Wind, and Neon for burst setups on turn 10, I guess. It's a bit hard to choose to go for a Wind Guild War 5-star now though, I'm not really struggling with any particular Earth content, and neither of them feels that irreplaceable anymore. As for the actual Guild Wars, which are usually the events I try to push a bit harder on, we'll be getting a Light one in November and a Dark one in January. After that, that's probably going to be 2 more months before the next one, if not 3, since it would land on the anniversary month, and there's no guarantee it'll be an Earth one, so Wind can wait. On the other hand, 6 is already pretty damn decent at 4-star and is only going to get better, so the choice is already kind of made. As far as the materials go, I'm going to need a few more silver relics, a bit more Earth quartz, and a few more light dragon scales to complete the 40 boxing process. I've farmed the weapon in the last Guild War, and even the rusted fists are ready to go. I'm also using this Excel sheet to track which weapons have got to turn into which element based on the material availability. That's pretty comfy. So it looks like I've found what I'll be doing next week. After the Guild War character, of course, comes the Evoker. I'm really glad the sandbox won't consume tickets, cause I might actually have to spam Arcarum a bunch. This page still has the materials listed for Alanan and Kay, but Geisenboger is going to be the next one. I actually have 2 Evolites, but there's still a few shared mats between Alanan and Geisen, and I'd rather complete the second one first. It looks like the road to my 5th Evoker is going to be a bit longer. I'm missing a few Sephira stones, I'm still at 67% for the Ideans, and barely past the halfway mark for the Astras. Everything else is mostly okay though, and I'm still sitting on 85 tickets that I'll be spending on the Telsus route. We'll see how long this takes. Lastly, weapons and grids. Fire is mostly fine, I've been saving a few extra souls for meme's sake, but I doubt I'll ever go for a 7 AES grid. I'm still holding a few canes as well, and I might try to pair them with the new Shiva staff should I get lucky with some more drops. Water is in a bit of a weak spot, as it always is. On the Magna side, I'm almost done with the 4th hop, and I'm farming up an Oberon grade. Too bad I don't have Summer Cagliostro pushed that past its limits. On the Primal side, I've got two Drank's Fields and a Murg maxed out. The Murg was actually a mistake from my early game, but it's not like I'm going to reduce it or anything. I'm also sitting on two Gottfrieds, two Europa Spears and two Folia Bows in case I'd want to go for a crit-based grade over a CA-based one, but the Meteora and the new Garrison weapon might be more interesting upgrades. For Earth, I'm pretty close to upgrading to a Titan grade. All I'd really need would be 3 bars on an AK-4A and 2 for the Elixir Dagger. But Magna came, doesn't feel all that bad, and we've just gone past the Guild Wars, so I guess I'm going to leave Earth as is. I've been leaving Wind a bit behind, the Magna 2 grid is alright, but I only have a 0-star Judgment and 0-star Raphael. I might go for them after Geisenboger and try farming the new Grimnir Spoon, see how it goes. Light is going to stay Magna regardless, I don't have the Edens nor enough bars to uncap them and go Zeus. So I'm just going to farm the two spears for the new meta grid and try it out a bit. As for Dark, I'm farming the Fidial Spine cause it looks like a real cool weapon. I'm working on the 4 spines OTK setup for the Guild War and I'm saving a few guns to see if and how a gun stamina grid works. Dark Primal, on the other hand, is fairly easy to build now. 30 moons and 3 bars for a Gisla, 1 bar for Colulus Spear, 1 bar for Ray's weapon, and I already have a Bloodgang Bard since a couple of years ago. Hades is going to eat 2 Sunstones and Sariel 3 though, which is a bit on the expensive side. But I do have 5 more bars in the shop as well as 6 Sunlight Stones, so I could go for it no problem while also being able to get Geisenboger either this month or the next. March of the Valiant is also going to bring more Valor Badges to purchase Sunlight Stones with, and hopefully there's going to be either more Sunstones or more Evolites in the Arcarum Sandbox, so even if I do run out, I won't be at 0 Sunlight Stones for long. I guess this is happening! I'm embracing Darkness and going Hades for my second Primal Grid. Alright then, that's going to be it for me for the moment. There is one last thing I need to do, which is to reorganize my themes, but that's going to take another video by itself. In the meantime, I hope this video had some useful information for you, and I'll see you guys soon. Thanks for watching, ciao!